stick in your cheek. Pulling tricks, looking slick at all times when I'm flipping. Bar sipping, car dipping, grand wood grain gripping. Still tipping, I'm still voting, I'm still rapping. Can't see up in my window. These niggas don't understand me, cause I'm boss hog on candy. Top down at Max's with a big Glock 9 handy. Pieced up, creased up, stand dressed to impress. Big boss belt buckle under my Mitchell and S. Oh, Gucci shades up on my braids when I escalate. When I'm riding spree wheel sliding like an escapade. I got it made, the big boss of the north. Ain't shit changed, I still represent what's your house.
Section, we want to talk about some cool TV shows. One of my two favorites shows that came out this year, last year, first season was Rick and Morty on Adult Swim, mm-hmm. and Bojack Horseman on Netflix. These two shows are some of the best animated shows out right now. It's the best, in my opinion, the best adult-oriented animated television out right now.
Ricardo, for those listening right now, and like for me, for example, what is Bojack about, and what is Rick and Morty about?
I'll start with Rick and Morty. Rick and Morty is just to put it quickly. If you were to just media pitch it to somebody, it's basically R-rated Futurama, right? Ooh. That's what it is. It in my opinion, it filled the hole that Futurama left when Futurama finally ended. Yeah, and
unfortunately, though, it was a really
bittersweet
end.
You needed that you know geek or nerd itch scratched. And for me, Rick and Morty does that very well. It came out last year. Its first season came out last year, and every episode was brilliant. It was just so well done, so smart, and it's based off of I think it's an internet animated short called Doc and Marty. When you watch Rick and Morty, you immediately see a simple comparison to the two characters from Back to the Future.
Right.
Marty McFly and Doc. Mm-hmm. And it's the same, generally the same premise if you just carry that to the nth degree. So the main character, Rick Sanchez, by the way, they're both voiced by the creator of the show, Justin Roiland.
Okay.
And the show is, it's, as I said, it's very, very funny. It does covers all of, like, the science, sci-fi stuff, multiple universes and parallel realities and that kind of stuff. It does that quite well. Rick constantly, you know, drives around in space. They cover pretty much every concept in sci-fi that he could cover. And then on top of that, they put a lot of dark, really raunchy, kind of nihilistic kind of humor in it as well. And yeah, I totally recommend the show. It's very, very smart. The first season was it just came out like a big hit for me. It just has a fast flowing moving with it. And not only have a lot of sci-fi references and geek humor in it, you also have a lot of comic book references in it as well. General geek humor, and as I said, the writing is on point. One of the big attraction for me in the show was this guy, Justin Harmon.
Justin Harmon, remind me who's
Justin Harmon. Creator of Community. I don't know if I probably get the name wrong there. Dan Harmon, sorry.
Yeah. Dan Harmon, right.
Yeah, I think he did the... Oh my gosh, you know, somebody will just Google it and correct me immediately online.
Is either he created it or...
Yeah, he was one of the head writers for Rick and Morty, but he did Community as well.
Yeah.
And it has a lot of... What makes... All right, so the big sending off point for Rick and Morty is that it's very, very meta.
Right.
Very, very much like Community. Very meta. These people almost pride themselves on subverting tropes. So you expect the story to go one way, and then they'll just switch it up on you and make it really, really work.
Right.
And the show really shines. That's the real shine of the show as well. It does that very, very well. I totally recommend the show to people. The second season recently started. I think this Sunday from the time of this recording. Sunday's today. The second episode will play out after the recording. So, but the thing is, the second episode leaked online already. A little bit of guilty. I went and watched it already.
You bastard!
Last week, the first episode played out, and that first episode was so well done. It's so clever. Because it ran way on the screen itself. They had like multiple realities playing out, and they made this big Schrodinger's cat reference to it about uncertainty.
What reference is that?
Quantum uncertainty. If you cannot observe something and measure it at the same time on the quantum level, all
right.
And it's a big science thing. And they had like a bunch of cats like in this alternate version of reality because they were stuck outside of time, and this was because of the events of the end of season one. Okay. So, they apparently, like, Rick is this super genius scientist, basically.
Right.
He basically, the analogy to him is, like, similar to Reed Richards in the Fantastic Four. He's, like, a raunchy version of that. And he's incredibly brilliant and a super genius at everything. He solves these problems immediately. And then he treks around. And the end of the first season had them freezing time to solve a problem. And I think the season pretty much ends at that. And then it starts back at that, but what happens is that they got bumped out of time. So you had, I mean, it's really, go watch it yourself because it's really, really trippy. So they had like, you see the screen itself split, but you see an alternate realities playing itself out with slight alterations now.
Right.
And so they show Morty doing something slightly different, and Morty's sister, she doing something a little different as well. And it's really, really clever. It's really difficult to follow. It's very convoluted, but it really worked quite well. The show, as I say, the show is a very smart show, but it's not. I'll say, however, it's on an emotional level, it's not particularly like well driven overall because it just does like some like high level stuff, but it's mostly because of the science stuff and the existential stuff. So it has a kind of lazy nihilism to it, but for the most part, that's the only small critique, and that's like a nitpick. The humor is very funny, Nick. Rick's character always like burps or belches for some reason, and I don't know if that was ever explained in the story. And okay. It has all these great references, great jokes in it, and yeah, I totally recommend Rick and Morty. Go see it. The second show I'd like to talk about is
before I get there, though. Yeah. I have to stop doing this, but one question though, like for somebody like me who haven't seen Rick and Morty, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do I need to know all the science? Scientific stuff about it, or is it just, you know, like, well, just go in casually and just like
the show it is engaging in that way because they have like a bunch of like really, again, the raunchy humor does that well, especially Rick's character, who, well, yeah, you'll have a lot of science stuff, but it much like with Futurama, it has a lot of simple humor,
but
you kind of need to know like this reference or this joke or this science to really, concept to really or whatever it is, yeah. So I'll admit, yeah, to fully appreciate it, you kind of have to know, you know, some scientific concept. You don't have to actually be a physicist. I'm not one. But you need to kind of see the concepts and the ideas. And they have a lot of great gender stuff. They have a lot of great, like, other ideas. All these you know, general concepts they'll do.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's just, you'll just enjoy it. You don't have to be a scientist to enjoy it. But again, it is more in line with Futurama in that way. So they do a lot of great humor, a lot of great ideas, and carry it to that extreme. They also make, like, references to other characters and cartoons. So apparently, and I found this out recently, there is a crossover to the much more PG Cartoon Network show Gravity Falls. And Gravity Falls is, in my opinion, really, really smart science stuff and for kids. And there's a reference to Gravity Falls, but it's a really small reference and you'll have to look for it. And I didn't even know it existed, but apparently it's like one of the characters chuck some stuff through a portal and you see it come through the portal in an episode of Rick and Morty. So,
serious?
Yeah, like, it's a real small reference, but you can find it. The thing is, admittedly, I don't watch Gravity Falls.
I haven't even heard of Gravity Falls until...
No, it's a great show. Okay. It's for kids. It's a much younger audience. Definitely not, you know, not like Rick and Morty, not as raunchy and risky as that show. No. But it is in the same vein of, you know, appreciation of science for kids. And they do a lot of references to... It's little knocks and little subtext against like shows like Adventure Time. You see little references to... Well, I expect to see a Steven Universe.
That would be awesome. Yeah. That
would be hilarious. I really like Steven Universe. I really like Adventure Time. And I really like Gravity Falls. And so, you know, it's for the adults and the kids. And to see the little crossovers. And, you know, it's really just that whole adult animation working really, really well. It is, in my opinion, one of the best shows Adult Swim has made in years. I'm really, really glad to see Dan Harmon and Justin Roiland on this. Roiland is brilliant. His voice work is brilliant. His writing is brilliant. The writing team is good. They have great voice actors behind it. They have, I think Chris Parnell does the dad, who's one of the Morty's dad is one of the funniest characters in the series. right. I think, what's her name? Sarah Clark. She used to be in Scrubs.
Okay.
Was he the other, what was her name? Elliot. Yeah, so I think she's the voice for the mother. As I say, Roiland does the both voices for Morty and Rick. And I can't remember who does Morty's sister, Summer. I forget who's the voice actress. But it's a great voice work. Really good animation, really good concepts. And yeah, I totally recommend Rick and Morty.
What about the next show now?
Just to cut into the next show. Mm-hmm. The other show is not comparable. It's a very different beast entirely. It's a show that came out last year called Bojack Horseman. And here's the thing. This show really caught me off guard because, when I heard about the show, I poisoned the well for myself, unfortunately, and I went and go on Metacritic. And I saw the score of the show at about 60 or something like that. It was a very, very low score.
Oh.
So people was like, well, the thing is, I'm a big fan of, his name's slipping me. He played Job on Arrested Development.
Not Will Arnett.
Yeah, Will Arnett. Yeah, Will Arnett. Yeah. Right. Yeah, Will Arnett. Big fan of that guy. He did a small little series. He had a small series before this. And I was like, well, I wonder what Will Arnett doing, you know. And he coming off the heels of season 4 in Arrested Development.
Yeah.
So I was like, all right, cool. You know, new show. Let's take it in. And the first episode or so was quite mediocre. It wasn't funny at all. It was kind of clever. It had its moment. And it's this very strange, surrealistic world where it's modern-day Hollywood. But you have, like, animals and humans living together. And all of them are sentient.
Mm-hmm.
So it's this really, really bizarre world. And so I was like, all right, it's just animals and humans living cohabitating. So, all right, cool. It kind of funny. They have like little strange stuff like, since everybody's sentient, apparently it's not really bestiality. So all the characters, like Bojack is this old television star who
has a horse's head. Because I saw.
Yeah, he's like a man. Like everybody looks like humans, but they look like animals as well. But the basic premise of it is that it's this guy who's this old television star back in the 90s. And he's this kind of washed-up star a la Charlie Sheen. Where he's in a mess and he just living off his money and he just, like, kind of a loser, not really doing anything. And as I said earlier with the show, it was quite mediocre the first few episodes.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't really take it on. And I totally understand why it has this 60% on Metacritic. It's not that great. It's not that funny. It's kind of okay. Yeah, okay. Mediocre. Yeah.
And then something happened in season 2 and then you were like,
wow. It's the middle of season 1. Oh. Apparently, it was judged only on the first 5 episodes. And that is what, like, threw off everybody. So, the first 5 episodes, yeah, is quite mediocre. And I it's a show that only had 13 episodes for the first season. So, I was like, all right, let me just watch it out. And then in the middle of they do something really awesome with Bojack's friend, and it was really deep. And then you start to learn about what the show is really about. It does the idea of depression very well. It is really a very, very, very powerful show from an emotionally intelligent aspect. And then they get to the end of season 1, and my gosh, it hits some seriously harsh emotional gut punches. It is. Think of it as like a very depressing song, but done in a upbeat melody, because it is a very funny show. They have a lot of great animal puns in it. The characters' names and it has some great voice acting.
Right.
So Will Arnett voices the main character, the titular character, Bojack Horseman. I think the girl who play Annie from Community.
Oh, her. Yeah.
Yeah. She does.
Name
she does.
Me right now.
Yeah, yeah. It's slipping my right now. It's the sad part. I need a list in front of me.
Yeah.
But she does the voice for the side character that comes in. She was like to write for it. Who's the guy who does from Breaking Bad?
Bryan Cranston?
No, side guy.
Jesse Pinkman's character.
Always saying bitch for some reason.
Yeah. Oh gosh, I'm forgetting names too. I don't know.
He does the voice for another side character who's Bojack's friend.
Oh, right. I actually remember that right after Breaking Bad season 5 ended.
Yeah.
He said that he was going to be involved in this show. So yeah, I remember that.
He plays this loser character. He's just this total bum who's bum on Bojack's couch, more or less. But he's a great side character. Aaron Paul. Yeah, Aaron Paul, right. Now I remember his name, right. Aaron Paul plays the side character. Great, great, funny character. Todd, right? And he's always, like, deprecated by Bojack. Shut up, Todd. The Then they have, I think, Amy Sedaris. She does a character called Princess. Oh, you're not really slipping me right now, you know. Like, really horrible.
Write notes, but before yeah, they, you do it, write
no,
your
no,
notes.
The sad part is I get put on the spot now, so.
No problem.
Yeah, man. Princess Caroline. Yeah, she mm-hmm. plays that character who's like a cat, but she's Bojack's agent. And since Bojack is the most loser character, she's constantly trying to bat for Bojack to keep him on board in the agency, no? In the talent agency, essentially. Yeah, she's voiced by Amy Sedaris. I'm a big fan of Amy Sedaris. She did a show called, there was an old show that on Comedy Central called Strangers Candy. She I've did, she was the main character in that, and that show was hilarious.
Yeah, heard
and it before. That's the first time I saw Stephen Colbert, because he played one of the teachers in the show. Great voice work. They have a lot of great, great people. They have like Keith Olbermann make cameos. They have a lot of great, this guy, Daniel Radcliffe, made a cameo this season, in second season.
Okay.
But the show, the real strength of the show is it's incredibly cynical. But it works. It's not a lazy cynicism. But it does a lot of classic humor at once. And as I say, it's like a dark song with a very happy melody.
Yeah.
It's like 99 Lofter Balloons. Anyone knows like what that song is actually about?
Ask Your Parents.
Huh?
Ask Your Parents. I know the song, yeah.
Yeah, it's like about, the song is about nuclear annihilation.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like super like distant.
It sounds like the happiest,
yeah, exactly.
The cheesiest, it's
the same thing
song,
with Bojack.
You know?
What it does very, very realistically, I think, it handles depression. And the show, you realize, has a lot of layers to it. It's very, very, very emotionally smart. I won't say it's deep in the sense of, like, philosophically deep or anything like that, but it does emotions very well. Like, how Bojack handles depression. Another thing they do very cleverly with the editing is that they handle time very strangely. Because one of the big things with depression is that it when you're very depressed, it messes up your sense of time. Like, time keeps going on, so you're not sure. You think a little bit of time passing, and realize that you lose a lot of time in your life.
Right.
And in terms of your whole progress of life. And it's reminiscent of one of my favorite movies, Synecdoche, New York, with Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Mm-hmm.
That show had the same kind of themes to it. I'm not sure if the creator of the show was influenced by that show, but it had a similar premise of interfering with time. Like, if you watch the Synecdoche, New York, the opening sequence, it's very, very strange and janky with respect to time. It's like, wait, didn't they say it was this date? But then when you look on the newspaper, it's this date. So you realize that he just playing out the same day over and over, and he just have it running as one day,
right.
Or just one morning. It's just his routine in the morning in breakfast, or just getting up, not realizing that he's been doing this for like months on end. Bojack has a really similar premise in terms of how time passes. So it's very difficult to follow how time passes, and you realize how he handles depression and how he deals with it. It's a very, very, very good show, though. It's very well written. And season 2 has a very high score on Metacritic, and it totally deserves it, because season 2, even season 1 had great emotional gut punches. Season 2, oh my gosh, they do such a good job with that. I don't want to spoil it.
Please
all
sir,
the episodes
please sir,
is out.
I
totally recommend it. You should have Netflix or whatever it is. I don't want to encourage piracy, but you should see it as much as you do it. I have Netflix. Go watch it. Totally recommend the show. So those are the two shows I really, really recommend for anybody who hasn't seen it by now. Season 2 recently started for both shows. In the case of Netflix, you could go watch it out one time, all 13 episodes. A lot of emotional strength in that. And then Rick and Morty just started, so it's on season... Well, at the time you're hearing this, more than likely episode 2 should be out by then on Adult Swim. Totally recommend these shows. Go see Rick and Morty and Bojack Horseman.
All right. I will definitely check out those shows, because I've always been meaning to check them out.
Yeah.
Like the Bojack, for example. Like I do my homework. You know, I do my homework. So like right now, there are a few lists online about best TV shows of the year. And I always seem to, Bojack always seems to be popping up.
Right.
I'm like, wow, you know, for an animated film that nobody knows about, it's getting a lot of great, you know, reviews.
Yeah, the season two was really good though. Because again, when what Bojack does very well is that it has a great sense of continuity. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, it builds that world quite well. Even though it's janky with respect to time management, it does continuity very well. So if you follow like this little thing, and then if you realize what the ramifications of that thing is, it actually makes it that much more tragic. So again, it's a show that totally deserves rewatching. It has a lot of layers. I really recommend the show. A lot of people who disparage the show, I don't think they watch the show in its full detail. I really recommend the show.
Maybe they just kind of get tuned off by how bizarre it looks, I guess.
Yeah, but, no, it's a bizarre show. It's bizarre in the sense of right? How the animals... Like, they do a whole really funny thing where you see characters, you see chickens in the world, but yet you see characters eating chicken. So it's a little weird stuff like that. But then in season 2, they explain it. They fully explain why you would have chickens and then why it is you'll eat chicken. And it makes it so much twisted and strange.
Okay.
But then it does a lot of great, and it also does a lot of great classic humor as well. Like, they had a whole bit in season 2 where they did this whole, like, Abbott and Costello style, who's on first bit. Right. Totally classic comedy bit, you know. But they do this really, really well. You'll know it when you see it. Don't want to spoil it for you. Immediately when you see it. It's very, very funny. All
right. Well, yeah, like I was saying, well, just based off of what you told me, yeah, they sound like some damn solid quality entertainment.
Yeah.
So I'm going to check those out.
Yeah, no, I totally recommend it.
Yeah.